No role plays, just real. Chris and Lorenzo share four decades of combined experience to help you become a more effective leader.
We've never really, as a workforce, spent a lot of time on making sure we're developing good leaders.
We'll be able to share stories, experience, mistakes, failures, successes.
This is Hacking Your Leadership.
Welcome to Hacking Your Leadership. I'm Chris.
And I'm Lorenzo.
And Lorenzo, on this episode, I want to talk about something that I've seen a lot over the years, but for some reason, it is coming up in my news feeds and LinkedIn feed a little bit more often for the last few months than it has over time. And this is this idea that something can be given to you as a leader with an investment of time. You know, you sit down with a leadership team and you go through something that might take an afternoon or a day-long seminar or a week-long retreat or whatever it is, and you go through these concepts with leaders, and then you expect the leaders to be able to go back and disseminate the information to their team, and you don't give them the same amount of time to do that. So they try to figure out the best way to kind of summarize it and move forward with it. And the one that seems to be coming up more often right now, though it's a concept that's been around for probably 6 or 7 years, is this idea around growth mindset.
Mm-hmm.
And I know you know it. I know you know what I'm talking about here, because this is growth mindset is it was initially coined by Carol Dweck maybe almost a decade ago now, and there's a lot of really good things to it. There's a lot of almost Simon Sinek-y ways of looking at being in the workforce, of having a growth mindset versus having a fixed mindset. But like anything, it has been kind of corrupted into this. How do we make sure that we can get this information to our teams as quickly as possible without actually putting in the work? And I don't want to like be hypercritical of it from that standpoint, because maybe you don't have time to put in the work. Maybe you're trying to get through your day and you've been told you have to kind of move forward with this, and you're trying to figure out how to best do that with your team, even though you're not given the same resources that were put into you on this. But it leads to this practice of print out the PDF and stick it on the break room door and then move forward and hope people actually do it. I know we've both kind of experienced this with a lot of things before, but have you kind of seen an uptick in this when it comes to the term growth mindset?
Yeah, no, to your point, like I think it's been around for a while now, and people have talked about it. And I think, now that we're kind of to a degree a little bit of post-pandemic and more gatherings, and I'm seeing a lot more stuff on LinkedIn with meetings going on across the country and teams coming together. And so right along with that, comes leadership theories and books and guest speakers and concepts. And so, it seems like it's one of those right now that seems to be top of mind for many organizations and individuals that are kind of in leadership roles or looking for leadership development. And so I love that we're talking about this and that we're kind of talking through and defining what it is, but also like the hurdles that you brought up is at the end of the day, sometimes, we leaders, you get concepts or you get information, or there is a strategy from an organization to kind of go out and implement this idea to your teams. And it makes a lot of sense. You get a chance to see it yourself. You get a chance to spend some time in a practice, in a breakout, in some type of an experience to like really gain how you feel and gain the knowledge, that you get from it. And then many times there's the whole like, and then take this back to your team. Which less time, less effort. You have the distractions sometimes of all the things that go on with the work that you do. So it can be very difficult to kind of cascade down in an effective and an engaging way. But yes, I've seen the growth mindset definitions and ideas and just talking points being shared more recently than I have in quite a while.
Yeah. This is tough because, on the one hand, there's no way to put, let's say you take your senior leaders in an organization and you put them through a week-long retreat or even an eight-hour day on a concept or something like this. And then when you say, now go back to your teams with this, what really should be interpreted by that is go back to your teams with this in practice. Practice this as leaders, not go back to your teams with this in that you need to teach them this the same way that you were taught it. First of all, going through something for a day or an afternoon or a week or whatever it is doesn't make you like anointed with the ability to teach others this thing in the same way that it was taught to you. You know, it's one of those like, you know, a little bit of knowledge is dangerous because it leads you to believe that you know it all versus, you know, the people who taught it to you probably were more adept in the nuances of whatever this concept was when you learned it, and now you're expected to go back and teach it. No, you're not. So if you can push back on that a little bit, if it's ever said to you, push back on it, because when you're taking something back, it means practice it. It means you were taught it. So now live it and practice it, not go back and disseminate the information in a prescriptive way, the way it was taught to you. So that's the first thing that I think it trips up a lot of people who go through these things. But when it comes to concepts like growth mindset and others like it, there is a natural tendency to want to turn it into a PowerPoint or a checkbox, you know, or a list of checkboxes. You know, this is what I learned. Now I'm gonna go back and I want to give it to you and expect you to disseminate it to your teams, and it's gonna trickle down all the way to the lowest levels of the organization, and now everybody will have the exact same benefit as I got going through a week-long retreat with the person who wrote the book on this. And clearly it's a game of telephone. Each level of leadership or in the organization that you go further and further down becomes less and less effective at being able to disseminate it. And growth mindset is one of these that I think can be particularly, it can happen very easily with this, because there's a lot of really great ideas when it comes to growth mindset that are good things. Like things that you, if you look at it on a poster, you think to yourself, yeah, of course this list is good and this list is bad. But what does it actually mean to put it into practice? And are you living it yourself, or are you just trying to teach it to others?
Not only knowing the definitions, but then actually going through any of these types of ideas or theories or concepts, and then considering, you know, not just practice, but like, how do you bring it to life? And what are the examples? And where can you share with a team or yourself where, you know, here is where we may be seeing some current success, or that we may be doing this without even knowing that we're doing it. And then here are some places where we may have opportunity with this. And I think that, you know, again, as leaders, you know, one of the biggest things that we've talked about is, you know, to be a leader, the first person you have to follow is the person in the mirror, which is really like self-accountability and self-awareness. Are you living what you're preaching? Are you doing the things that you're asking your people and your team to do? And so, like, by definition, growth mindset is just believes that intelligence and talent can be improved. A fixed mindset believes that talent and intelligence are fixed. And so as a leader, you know, are you doing the things that you're asking your people to do? So if I'm saying that, you know, we're going to focus on growth mindset. Okay, so the first one is kind of easy. So do we see intelligence as something that we can develop over time? Or do we see intelligence and talent as fixed? So we can talk about ways in which we've grown. We can share our personal testimony with our teams around, here's where I didn't really get this, or I learned this, or I figured this out. Here's where I think I've gotten smarter and more efficient or more effective in some of the work that I've done. And then also having some dialogue around, how do you think that I've done? Have I gotten better at these things? And again, like, that is the practice element of bringing this to life with a team. Another example out of this is kind of the motivation element, which is willingness to embrace challenges and risks possible failure and growth mindset. So you are taking challenges and risking failure versus avoiding challenges to prevent the possibility of failure. I read that as a leader and I say, how good are you at delegating? How good are you at giving up control?
Uh-huh.
How much are you willing to put your money on your people and say, you know what? I'm going to give them the chance to take and go do this great work. And if they fail, I've learned. Now, of course, there's a bandwidth, you know, there's a spectrum of the decisions that people can make.
Of course.
But like, if the growth mindset leads to embracing flaws and mistakes as opportunities for growth and accepting setbacks as part of the learning process and feeling empowered to reach goals, like, that has to be you. You have to look at those things and say, am I doing these things? Because if you're going to try to implement any type of concept or theory to your team, the first thing you got to be able to check off is, am I either doing this? And if I'm not, am I willing to go in front of my team and tell them that I'm not, and that I'm also working on this? And that's a critical part of implementing any type of a theory or concept like this.
So the question I'll ask you then is that have you seen one of these things being implemented in that incorrect way? Like a specific item, if there's something that kind of stands out to you where you say, oh, I've seen this been, you know, put into practice incorrectly by a leader who believed they were doing it the correct way, but they definitely were not.
Specific to growth mindset versus fixed mindset, I think one of the things that's interesting in fixed mindset is it says hiding flaws and mistakes. So if you are a leader where you're not working through this and sharing what are your flaws and when have you made mistakes, and especially with that team, if you're looking to kind of build a movement here and get people to understand the concept and want to practice it for themselves, you have to lead with talking about maybe the flaws and mistakes that you've had. You're not hiding them. You're out in front of them. Maybe where it says here, you're being unmotivated to strive for or achieve goals, right? If you're not saying, hey, I believe this is a great thing, I think this is something that we should all practice, now let me share with you where maybe I have been stuck in a fixed mindset. And here's an example that happened a month ago. Remember when we had to do this thing and I was unmotivated to achieve that goal? I felt like we couldn't do it. I felt like it was impossible. I felt like there was no way. And then because of that, we didn't do the best that we could have done. Or one of you said we can do this and you proved to me that we could, and I was the one that was stuck. Like, that is the right way, in my opinion, of working through these types of concepts. I think, but that's where leaders get stuck, is that they want to go right into like TED Talk mode, which is, let me tell you what it is. Let me tell you what you got to go do. Let me give you examples of where you're not in a growth mindset. Let me give you examples of where you are all stuck in a fixed mindset. And the leader doesn't take any time to share their own personal pieces of this and bring the team along and saying, we're doing this together. It becomes a us and them type of a thing. And I think that's where most leaders make mistakes when they try to implement this type of a theory.
Yeah. What I see as problematic when it comes to this, though, is that during the course of whatever that leader went through, whether they were the time was invested into them to make sure they got these concepts right, they probably had to go through exercises like that. Mm-hmm. They probably had to go through exercises where they talked with people on the times that this was a failure for them versus a success. And so it's not just that they don't have the ability to articulate it. It's that they think they've arrived. They think they're at the mountaintop, right? They've gone through this. Maybe they actually did go through it with another group of people, either their peers or people in other organizations, whatever the seminar was they went through. Now they're going back and they think, okay, now I'm on top of the mountain. I don't have to have my come to Jesus moment. Now it's my turn to help you get to yours. And they don't start with the fact that the people you're talking to now weren't in that room with you when you were having your moment. They weren't in that room with you when you showed the humility that was needed to be able to get through this and go through the learning. And so it's not enough to even have gone through it yourself. You have to go back and bring that back with you in order to earn the credibility to be able to teach it, or to earn the trust from your team who you need to be able to react to it from a standpoint of, okay, I'm not just being told to do something here. I'm being told to do something by someone who actually has the right to tell me to do it because they've gone through it also. And having that right is a really important thing. And I'm not talking about having the right to do it. Like, you can say whatever you want to, and maybe your title gives you the right to prescribe things to your team. Having the right to do something means, do people interpret it in a way that will lead them to say, this is the right way forward, and now I'm going to go and execute it. I'm going to do it in the right way. That's what having the right to do it is. You can say it. Say it all you want to. The right to do it means, will people take this and run with it and do what they're supposed to do with it because they have inherent trust in me and they believe that what I'm saying to them is something that I preach myself, that I'm not just like moving on to them so I don't have to do any work myself.
No, that's a great call. And I know you kind of asked me of like, where do I see this as where leaders kind of, you know, have the hardest time maybe implementing these things. But have you ever been in a room where a leader has either been teaching a concept or theory or trying to explain it, and you're thinking to yourself, okay, I don't exactly know where they're going with this, or like that makes sense, but like I feel like I'm missing something.
Oh yeah, oh, of course I have. I've been in the room with leaders over time who run the gamut from teaching something and trying desperately to lead me and others to believe that they really know what they're talking about, when in actuality they're just trying to avoid looking like they don't know what they're talking about. And then they'll end up saying things that contradict each other, not intentionally, but because they believe that's what they're being told to read. And then there are moments where you watch them realize that what they just said contradicts the thing they said 5 minutes ago. and they realize that, oh, they went from, you know, reading the presenter note in the PowerPoint of what you should be doing, and then going to reading the presenter note of what you shouldn't be doing. And they said them both in the same way, which is like, this is both what you should be doing. And it belies a lack of preparedness. I've also been in rooms with leaders who have found themselves in a situation like that. And the first thing they say is, hey, just so you know, I was given this 3 days ago and I'm teaching this to you and I've read it through a couple times, but this is new to me too. So we're going to learn it together. And I want feedback on what you think this means to you, because this is the high level of what I've been told it's supposed to mean. But let's go through this and talk about it together. Now, you might be less likely to land with your team the truest and most pure form of what it was meant to be by whoever wrote it or who authored it. But the expense of that comes at the success of saying that whatever parts of it you are able to land are parts that you are truly landing. The team will come along for the ride with you because you started with that humility. And when I see that happen, there's a tremendous amount of grace that the leader gets for going and saying that. And even if they say it from a standpoint of, hey, I was given this a week ago, but I got a lot on my plate and I looked at it for the first time last night. That's the same thing to me as I was given it yesterday and I really couldn't read it in advance, but now we got to go through it together. It doesn't matter, you know, what the cause of it was. It's, are you trying to give the impression that you are an expert in this, or that you know what you're talking about? Or are you being honest with your team about what your level of living this versus being able to teach it versus just being able to try to learn it yourself, wherever you fall on that spectrum? Are you being honest with yourself and with us about where you fall on that as you're trying to give it to us? And if that honesty is there, then we can all get through anything together. If that honesty is not there, then it brings with it just a lack of ability to bring anything to your team at all. Because that's where people will get stuck, is this person talking to me right now doesn't actually believe what they're saying, or at the very least, they have no idea what they're talking about.
Yeah, absolutely. And with that, it brings us to this episode's 1 Minute Hack. But first, a few words from our sponsors.
The 1 Minute Hack.
All right, for this episode's 1 Minute Hack, here's what I want you to do. The next time you're in a situation where you're being taught something like this, and it could be growth mindset, because that's kind of a big thing right now, or it could be anything where you're being taught a concept or a strategy or a theory by somebody else who seems to really know what they're talking about when it comes to that particular thing. Don't go into that thinking, how do I teach this to my team in the same way it's being taught to me? Go into it thinking, how do I learn the most about this from a standpoint of implementing it in my own life and in my own leadership style? Write down your notes in a way that says, when I go back to my team, I'm going to start by explaining to them, here's how I'm trying to change my own leadership style through these concepts. Not, here's how I'm going to tell you how to change your leadership style, like I'm just passing along a note from one person to another. If you can go into any conversation like that with your team, starting with that standpoint of, here's what I've learned, and here's what I'm struggling with, and here's how I'm not going to be able to give the exact same thing to you that was given to me, because the time that we have and the preparation and the training is just not the same when it goes from level to level, the more you'll be likely to have a team that listens to you from a standpoint of, how do we get the most out of this too? And they'll be more likely to help you move further along in your journey to accomplish the things that you're trying to accomplish. So start with the humility and the communication and the notes from a standpoint of, how do I improve myself, not how do I improve my team?
Yeah, I think it's a great 1 Minute Hack, and like it truly is role modeling what you're asking your team to do. Like I'm sharing with you how I am looking to improve myself, where I think I'm doing, you know, potentially good work with this kind of idea or thought, or here's some examples of how I think we do this collectively well, and then here's the things that I'm learning, and here's the things that I need to get better as the leader, because you know, by role modeling that, your team will then follow and say, okay, cool, like I can accept that and I agree. Or maybe there's even dialogue around where they're saying, actually, we feel that you do this better than you give yourself credit for. But before you're asking them to accept and change a behavior to follow a certain concept or theory, I think it's so critical as leaders that we do it first.
Right. And when you say before, not before in that, you know, the acceptance is slide 3 and then the prescriptive is slide 4.
Right.
Before means you start with days or weeks of actually living it and practicing it for yourself. And then when you disseminate it, you're talking about it from a standpoint of, here are my learnings over this time. It can't just be that you talk about how you're trying to get better at it. They need to be able to look at your actions over that time and say, oh yeah, I can see what Lorenzo says when he says he's trying to work on this, because ever since he came back from that thing, I can notice he's doing this and this and this and this and this. That has to go along with it. It can't just be what you're saying that you're doing to improve yourself. It's what you're actually doing. The actions have to back up what you're saying.
Absolutely. And with that, it brings us to the end of this episode. This is Hacking Your Leadership. I'm Lorenzo.
And I'm Chris.
And we'll talk to you all next time.